Hi, this is Larry London. Welcome to Border Crossings Today. We are joined by a very special guest. She is not only one of the most talented 17-year-olds on the planet, but she's also one of the hardest working 17-year-olds on the planet. We'd like to welcome to Border Crossings and the Voice of America, Tate McRae. Welcome to VOA.
Thank you for having me.
It's great to have you on. Now, you're a high school senior and you're balancing this big career with this song that's got over 800 million streams already. How are you handling all this stuff with the COVID going on at the same time?
It definitely was a big struggle last year, especially. I mean, I'm like almost done. I have like one more credit before I have to finish, but it's definitely been a struggle just because I love the music so much more than doing the school. So I think that is obviously hard. It's just hard to stay motivated.
And it's got to be kind of a challenging situation for you to be in because you're graduating high school. Probably the plan was to go to college, but along comes fame and fortune. And, you know, even the best plans change. So what will the future hold for Tate McRae? What are you thinking about next year?
I mean, honestly, who knows like what's going to happen with the world within the next couple years. But I think after I start going on tour and stuff, I hopefully want to move to LA and start building a life there. I mean, the hard part is that there's not much of a scene in Calgary in Canada. So most of my sessions are over Zoom, which kind of sucks. But hopefully that one day I'll be able to go over to LA and start working there more consistently.
It doesn't seem to have hurt your career with all of the accolades and attention you're getting on the Billboard and TikTok. And of course, Apple Music just gave you a big honor and everybody's singing your praises while you're singing your current hit. And of course, we're here to talk about a brand new hit that you just put out just a matter of days ago, which is a song called Slower. So is this whole album Too Young to Be Sad? Is this a sad album? Is it a love song album? What's the vibe behind the new album?
So I did notice a guy was like, damn it, there's a lot of heartbreak songs in this EP. And I mean, the thing about that is like, obviously I do write about love a lot. And I that idea of with relationships, even if it's in a total, like even for Rubber Band, it wasn't about love, even though it seemed like it was about addiction and coping with addiction. So I think there's like obviously different interpretations for that. But with this title, I was thinking about it and I was like, there are so many damn heartbreak songs in this. But then again, I want to live my life. And I'm like, I don't have time to be sitting in my sulking. I need to be, you know, yeah, I'm too young for that. That's kind of like what I was going for.
If I read that correctly, you wrote You Broke Me First when you were in middle school.
So I wrote Slower in middle school.
Slower, the new single. Okay.
Yeah, when I was 14 or 15. I wrote You Broke Me First last year in January. But Slower was written when I was, I think, 14 or 15. And I was a little baby. It was like one of my first sessions in real life. And it's so funny that I like got to actually recreate it again.
And you talk a lot about love in your music. So the question would be for a 17-year-old in high school, are you in love? I think that song You Broke Me First was about a guy.
I think the funny thing is I have like a crazy imagination. I love writing. So like writing stories, making up, I don't know, stuff. Even if I didn't go through like this massive heartbreak, I can still picture it in my head. And so sometimes I'll take like really great relationships and I'll like imagine if something tragic happened. and then that's how I grab like real emotion, because if you take something that you really, really care about and you say, all right, this is, what if this ever happened to it? It evokes a lot of real feeling. Mm.
What's your favorite part of this business? Is it the songwriting? Is it the performing and singing? What do you like more?
Well, I love performing. I think it's definitely like the best feeling ever when you have people singing back your music. Mm-hmm. I only got to experience that in like seven cities on my first headlining tour. So I feel like I didn't even get the full experience for that, but writing has definitely been, you know, it's like my outlet for everything.
Mm. Yeah, the tour shut down, I think, after your Berlin show a year ago, right? Something like that?
Yeah, no, it was quick, and I got sent home, so I didn't get to experience much.
Now, speaking of writing, you wrote or co-wrote a song with Billie Eilish on the new album?
No, it was on my last EP. And
the last EP.
It was the last EP, and it was my first single with RCA Records. It was Billy and Phineas's song, so I didn't write that one. I usually write a lot of my music except for that one, and it was just, it was cool. I mean, I was 16, going into, like, my first ever record with the label and having Billie Eilish write it was, I think, just really cool.
Mm-hmm. And I mean, how does that work? You call her up and say, Billie, I want to record your track, or she calls you and says, Tate, would you record my song? Or
I wish I was that buddy with her. no, I just got offered the song to sing it, and I, you know, obviously listened to it, and I really loved it and got to track it. So I honestly don't even know how it fell into place, but it did.
To show business by any means, because when you were, I don't know, 13, I think it was, you appeared on the So You Think You Can Dance, and you did very, very well on that TV show. And I think you also were a dancer for Demi Lovato on the American Music Awards, if I'm not mistaken. So you've done a lot of different things in the world of dance. And I think you started off with ballet.
Yeah, I've been dancing. I honestly thought I was going to be a professional dancer when I grew up. I took it super seriously, and I started, you know, kind of creating like a professional career when I was 12. So it was like, I was doing the full industry situation at a really young age and taking it super seriously before anything. And the music kind of was just always my thing that I had with me, but I never really knew how to enter the music industry. It seemed kind of impossible to like get in. Like that's like the most, you know, scariest thing to put yourself into, throw yourself out there with a random song.
Mm-hmm. And mom was your coach or your ballet teacher, or she is a dance teacher, I read?
Yeah, she's my dance teacher.
That's great. And she's the reason you guys, you know, moved to the Middle East, her dance career.
It was my dad. Why, for his work, we moved to the Middle East when I was like baby. I wish I remembered it because we like traveled the world when I was younger. But I started dancing mostly when I came back to Canada and started training. Mm-hmm.
What was life? You don't remember life in the Middle East because you were so young?
I remember subtle things. Like, mm-hmm. I remember we used to camp on beaches in Dubai every 2 weeks or something.
Wow.
Like, we did, like, really cool stuff that I only really remember because of pictures and stuff, but it's cool.
That's excellent. I mean, that's amazing that you have that international background. And, of course, you're one of two kids. You know, Tucker plays hockey, I guess, and you're not interested in hockey. I thought every Canadian has to play hockey by birth.
I actually wanted to be a hockey player for a day, and then I realized I can't skate and I don't like it. So,
so tell me about the new song Slower. What's the inspiration? How did that song come to you? Where did you write it? When did you write it?
So Slower, I wrote it when I was around 14 or 15. Mm-hmm. And it honestly, it's funny because the idea and the whole story behind this song has changed so much now that I'm 2 or 3 years older. And it originally was about like a guy, and, you know, there's a lot of thinging stages that happen in your 13, 14, 15 stages. And it was honestly just about this feeling of, all right, well, I'm going to move on with our life if you don't, you know, make up your mind. I was like, you gotta be straight up with me, otherwise I'm gonna move on and I'm gonna, you know, start working and just not, you know. And that's kind of what I wrote it about. And it's funny because now it has that whole sense of you just got to be present because things can slip out of your hands in seconds. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of how I interpret it now, which is crazy because I'm 17.
And so the new EP is coming out on the 26th, which I believe when this airs, it'll be this week. And it's called Too Young to Be Sad. And you're not sad. You seem very happy.
Yeah. I think there's a part of me that I love. I have a very fortunate life. Obviously, I'm like super grateful for what I get to do. But I'm also like a super overthinker and a pretty observant person. So I take on a lot of energies of people. And I just like, you know, there's my perception of life that I think my brain is always working and I haven't always connected with like the people around me or when I was younger. So I think that's mostly where my writing came from. And, you know, when people always say like, why do you write sad songs? It's usually just because of my, that's the part that I probably wouldn't present in real life to people, but that's the part that I would write down on a piece of paper.
Well, being a great singer of love songs is not a bad thing either. So, you know, which you are, you're tremendously talented. I'm sure there's lots of surprises coming down the road in the future. And the new album is really, really exciting. And do you have plans to go out on tour? And, you know, your song, Broke Me First was number one, I think 30 countries or more than that around the world. And we're broadcasting in most of those countries. VOA reaches 100 countries and 275 million people. So your music is heard by most of our audience all around the planet. And that's got to be exciting. Just knowing that when this thing ends and it's ending soon, you'll be able to actually go out on the road and visit these countries.
I'm just so excited for that. I mean, I think the last time I was on tour, my life has changed so much since then, since last January. So I think just seeing people and like even going to be able to perform that song, I think is going to be crazy. They already are. My supporters who come to shows are always so loud. I love it. They just scream every song. So I'm so excited to perform You Broke Me First and see how that one goes too.
It must be an amazing feeling for you, for anybody for that matter, to be on stage in a country that doesn't speak English, but they know the lyrics to your songs. They can sing every word.
Yeah, that's really cool. It's something I've never experienced before. It's like a weird, surreal feeling. You can't really explain.
Now, did I read this correctly? You have been dealing with anxiety from time to time. Is that an ongoing issue in your life? You're only 17.
I mean, for sure. I'm my biggest critic. Like, I'm also a pretty stress-free person in real life. And then I think a lot of it is like stuck inside my brain where I don't really talk about it a lot. I mean, there's a lot of pressure. There's that idea of I'm a super perfectionist, and I have been since I was 9 years old. And so while my friends would be going out on a Friday night, I'll be sitting in my room writing about or thinking about what I need to do to shape my future or do things to like, you know, create the best work as I possibly can. And that's like stressful to me. And I think that that's where I carry my stress, is wanting things to be just like perfect for my supporters. And obviously that comes with some sort of weight.
Does your fans have a name yet? Have you named your fan club?
Yeah, they've named themselves the Tater Tots.
The Tater Tots. All right. I'm signing up. I love it. That's great. And you really are a breath of fresh air. I mean, and that's why everybody has taken note of Tate McRae and all of your talents. Even though this is just the beginning of the journey, you've got two EPs or something like that out. And I know you've been writing music for a while. You're also the voice of an animated character in a film, Lala Loopsy. And so do you have any aspiration to actually appear and act in films? Is that something on your to-do list?
I mean, maybe when I'm older. I think right now it's definitely music-based right now, but that'd be cool. Pull a J-Lo moment. You can sing and act. That'd be really cool.
Well, you are really, really an inspiration, as I say, and a role model for a lot of young girls who look up to you. I mean, balancing all of this, dealing with all the challenges that are on top of COVID and everything else, and turning your career into a big, giant success story, which is huge. Congratulations. You deserve all of the fame and accolades that you're getting.
Thank you very much. It means a
lot.
Yeah,
and I do hope that when this all clears up and you're in D.C., you will come in our studio so I can see you in person.
Let's do it.
All right. Tate McRae and Too Young to Be Sad is the name of the new EP. March 26th is the drop date. Get a copy. And by the way, where are your websites, your social media sites? Where can people reach out to you?
Just at Tate McRae, usually Instagram, TikTok, Twitter, everywhere. All right.
Well, thank you so much, Tate McRae, for joining us here on Border Crossings. Her new EP is called Too Young to Be Sad. It's coming out this week. Make sure you pick up a copy. She's tremendously talented, a lot of fun to talk to, and a really, really great writer and performer. You're going to be hearing that name a lot in the future. Thank you for joining us today. Tate McRae, our guest. I'm Larry London, and you are watching Border Crossings.